And so these monotheistic faiths might be considered singularly unsuitable in the cold, dank north of birches, pines, mosquitoes, bogs and bog bodies. However, Christianity did thrive. The Teutonic Knights knocked the love of one god, one fictive delusion, into people who had previously had many gods, many fictive delusions. The Knights' evangelical assault suggests that a religion is no more than a cult with an army attached to it. The indigenous religion was driven underground, to be periodically exhumed by those with elephantine folk memories. The imported religion promised that no matter how dour this life may be, and life in the north was dour, everything will be just dandy in the next life if you believe in and worship the one God. So it enjoyed an understandable appeal. The number of churches in Vilnius might be held to attest to that appeal. The city is as triumphantly Baroque as Rome. The Counter-Reformation style of the Catholic Church was gross, vulgar, populist, energetic, thrilling. But it was hardly Lithuanian. It is Italian by way of Poland, which had annexed Lithuania. So the majority of these churches were designed by Poles. And like most architects before and since, they were enthusiastic followers of fashion. They doggedly ransacked the Italian pattern book for ideas. This was then a double colonization, a double invasion. But that is Lithuania's fate. It has been so frequently invaded and colonized and annexed that its buildings are the calling cards of its violators, who of course did not see themselves as violators. These churches may imitate Italy's, but they could never be taken for Italian. Their surroundings, their conjunction with the street, their materials, the light that illuminates them, all these are unmistakably northern. And so is the routinely vain attempt to appear southern, to seize at a link with the sun, if only by association. Vilnius's most fascinating church, however, is an exception to the touchingly hopeless aspiration to southernness. Furthermore, it is not Baroque. Well, not formally Baroque, not chronologically Baroque. It belongs actually to the later Middle Ages. Yet, in the restlessness of its many devices, and in the very form of certain of those devices, it appears to predict the Baroque. Because architectural history is founded in what happened in the south, in Italy, it remains unthinkingly biased towards that country. So to talk of an architectural renaissance in the north is to apply to northern Europe the inappropriate model of the south. In the north, things happened differently. The Gothic, born in northern France and naturalized everywhere north of northern France, endured far longer here than it did in places south of the Loire, places such as Italy, where Gothic was a term of abuse, like pagan. More than half a millennium after it was supposedly Christianized, Lithuania still clings both to vestiges of its pagan polytheism and to a preoccupation with its forests. One reason for this is because forests are larders, full of partridges, boars, bears, and even beaver. I've never eaten bear, but I have eaten beaver, and I highly recommend it.
Not this kind of beaver, though. This beaver is, it's like spaniel. It's like spaniel dipped in cod liver oil.
Lithuania's lakes, too, are larders. Perch, roach, tench, chub, and most especially pike and carp. They're caught for the table, not to be put in a keep net, photographed and thrown back. The Jewish, specifically Ashkenazi culinary repertoire, includes countless recipes for freshwater fish. In the Book of Jewish Food, well named for it is the book, Claudia Roden lists sweet and sour, jellied, formed into dumplings, fried and eaten cold, salted, fried and subsequently pickled. Before they murdered their victims, the Nazis devised many minor humiliations for them. Leviticus, for instance, specifically prohibits the tattooing of the human body. Again, Auschwitz was revered and renowned throughout the Jewish world for the quality of the carp that had been bred in ponds there since they were introduced by Jewish merchants from China in the 1600s. Jewish cooking has all but disappeared from Lithuania. A way of life was extinguished with the race. What does remain is a curious anomaly. The Karaim in Lithuania are of Crimean and Eastern Turkish origin. Because they do not acknowledge rabbinical interpretations of the Talmud, they were considered apostates. For this reason, and because of their Tatar bloodline, the SS's Race and Settlement Office decreed that the Karaim were not to be considered Jewish. Thus they were spared. Some even fought for the Nazis. In the town of Trakai, a small community still prospers. It worships at Knesses and runs a series of cafes which specialise in kibinai, which is what Cornish pasties ought to be, but seldom are. The dish and word kibinai are evidently related to kibe, which are found in the eastern Mediterranean.
This is not just food. This is Karaim food.
The Karaim's cafes stare out onto a medieval castle. Admittedly, alongside the Teutonic Knights Malbork, it is little more than a starter castle. Nonetheless, it's a graphic illustration of Lithuania's former might. Karaim apart, less than 20,000 Jews survived the Second World War in Lithuania. Probably a quarter of a million had been massacred in the camps, by firing squads, by mobile gas chambers. Forests can be made as beautiful or as ugly as humans want them to be.